Honors. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes if I could watch the clock. Okay. The basic issue with respect to the constitutional violation as it relates to the single-family residence, I have to make those distinctions. There's a constitutional issue with respect to the single-family residence, and there's a constitutional issue with respect to the revetment or the riprap wall, is that the problem is that Clackamas County is applying ZDO 703 to property which is not covered by ZDO 703. Specifically, in that statute, it says that the flood management district is defined. It is defined as property which is below BFE, which is base flood elevation. There is no scientific evidence from the county that this property, well, I'll call the footprint,
inclusion with regards to the larger area, and that you were told if you want to change that, go to FEMA.
Well, we did go to FEMA.
FEMA, when it looked at it, reiterated that it thought that it was in fact.
Well, actually, there are two things that happened. The first thing that happened is that, and again, if you look at 703.08, I believe, or 05I, the elevation certificate, the county is required to use the elevation certificate for all reporting. In other words, that is the gold standard. My client was told to go to FEMA for a LOMA. He went to FEMA for a LOMA. The first thing that we find in buried information is that the people from FEMA said the elevation certificate is correct.
I thought they said it was not correct.
No, there were FEMA contracts out with a company called STAR to determine whether or not the elevation certificates are correct. They did that. STAR came back and said the elevation certificate is correct as to BFE. Then Clackamas County sent a letter to FEMA and said, oh, wait, I didn't think you were going to do that. I thought you were going to deny it. So then FEMA, but not STAR, someone from FEMA wrote a letter which was not an official letter from FEMA. It says so right on there. It says this is not, the case is not closed. This is not an official closure of the case. That's when they said, well, we've determined that the BFE, that the property is below BFE. But all FEMA was doing at that point was reading the map. And that's not how you determine BFE. The gold standard for BFE and the basis for application of the flood management ordinance is an elevation certificate. It is the gold standard. FEMA, neither FEMA nor Clackamas County ever contradicted the elevation certificate. So that's the problem. And here's the other problem with what happened. When my client received the denial of the FDP, he was said, go to FEMA. And he was told, if you go to FEMA and you find that there are parts of the property that are above BFE and therefore not within the flood management district outside of the boundaries, we will respect it. What happened, though, was that they later on said, when they were asked to do a community acknowledgement, and by the way, the community acknowledgement was for the footprint. Community acknowledgement basically says there's no fill on the on the subject property.
But there really wasn't.
No, there wasn't.
But they said there was.
Not on the subject property.
But I thought they thought there was.
Who said?
I thought they thought there was, i.e., the riprap wall, or whatever it's called.
No. That's different. It's a big piece of property, and there's hills on the property, and there's the riprap definitely is in the flood management district because it's in the river. Right? There's no question about that. But other pieces of property are above the river and not in a flood zone. So what you look at is whether or not that particular property, the footprint, you look to whether that particular footprint was fill. And they never said that the footprint was fill. What they did was when we were going through the LOMA process, Clackamas County said, we're not going to sign this community acknowledgement because there's fill over here. We asked for a LOMA for the footprint. So the question is there fill on the footprint? Unequivocally, no evidence that there was ever any fill on the footprint.
It was all very confusing. I understood that the flood management area, or whatever it's called, was a large area because you can't go piece by piece, and that within that large area, another area was designated as floodway, which is for purposes of areas that would be entirely clear for regulatory purposes, and that whether a particular subpart of the land may or may not be under the flood level is not the question.
It is the question because the flood management district is not defined as the map. It's defined as property that is below BFE. That's the difference. And FEMA recognizes, the county recognizes, everybody recognizes that these maps are approximations. Somebody drew a line on the map and said, I think this is a floodway. I think this is a floodplain. But you can overcome that.
Floodway and floodplain are not the same thing.
Floodway is below a floodplain. It's a channel of a river. Floodplain is the whole, when you have a flood, it's the level of the flood. The floodway is where the flood drains. So it's the current, or the channel of the river. So it's actually below floodplain.
And I thought the problem here was precisely that this is a floodway, and that's why you couldn't build it at all.
Except that the elevation certificate says that the flood plain, the level of the flood plain, is a certain level, 117.8 feet. That's the BFE. So the floodway necessarily had to be below that, so the property obviously is above the floodway if it's above the floodplain.
Well, that gets us back to the elevation certificate.
Excuse me?
That gets us back to the elevation certificate, which
yes.
You say is the gold standard.
I say it's the gold standard because that's what the statutes say.
Okay.
It says here, and this is 70305I, it explains what an elevation certificate is. And it says that communities that participate in a community rating system are required to use an elevation certificate for all official reporting and record keeping of elevations. This is a request to build a piece of property on land. It is an official record. You have to use the elevation certificate to say that land is at 117.8 feet.
This was a piece of paper that you yourself produced, that your client produced on your own behalf, right? It wasn't agreed to by anybody. It was simply what your expert said, as I understand.
The elevation certificate?
Yes.
It is, again, it's the gold standard. We set the elevation certificate because that's what FEMA says to do,
well,
and that's what 703
says. If you find some expert who says that this is not under the BFE, that's it? If you come up with some expert, nobody gets to disagree with it?
It's not just an expert. It's a surveyor who, if he's lying about it, if he missed...
Well, whatever. But I mean, your claim is that neither the county nor FEMA can disagree with your document.
No, my claim is that neither the county nor FEMA disagreed with my expert.
Well, FEMA
there is no,
they said it was wrong.
No. The only thing FEMA said was that the map is right. They did not say that the elevation certificate was wrong. And according to the emails that we recovered, what FEMA said first, and through STAR, which is their contracting agency, what they said first was, your elevation certificate is correct. That's exactly what they said.
So what all of this goes to, ultimately, is the contention that there was, in fact, a property right here because they had a property right to have the determination made based on the certificate. Is that essentially what you're saying? That they shouldn't have even needed a permit at all because this was not covered by the statute. Is that what you're saying?
Was it's not that it's that simple, and it's not that simple. It is my client had a reasonable expectation based upon the law that she could build on this property. And the reasonable expectation not only came from all of the statements.
The law
statements,
says that if you're not below, if there you have a certificate that says you're below, that you're not below the BFD, then you have a right to build. Is that what you're saying? No, with no permits or anything else.
If you have a certificate that says that you are above BFE, you are above BFE.
And
there is no proof to the contrary.
And you get a certificate, then you don't need a certificate, then what?
Typically what happened, and this is what happened in this case, historically this is what happened. This is a property that's close to the river, so you need a PRCA permit, Primary River Conservation Area permit. You submit the Primary River Conservation Area permit. With it, you give them an elevation certificate. You obtain the PRCA permit, and you build the house.
So
and because
that my question, that you automatically get a permit then, or that you don't need a permit?
We didn't automatically get a permit. We had to apply for a PRCA.
Can I answer my question?
Oh, okay.
I want to know how this hooks into the constitutional property right question. So are you saying that they therefore had to give them an FTP permit, or they didn't need an FTP permit, or what?
Not only did they not have to give him one, they couldn't give him one because he wasn't in a floodplain development area. He wasn't in a floodplain management area.
He shouldn't have had to apply for one.
He shouldn't have had to apply for one because it didn't apply. He wasn't in a floodplain management district if he was above BFE. It doesn't make any sense to have floodplain management requirements. For example, it wouldn't make any sense to say if someone is above the floodplain to anchor your house as if it's below the floodplain.
I thought FEMA had sided with the county on whether this lot was below BFE, and I was just trying to find the letter. You said that there was some informal letter?
Yes.
Is that the ER?
There's no question there was a letter.
Is ER 310, is that where that letter is found?
I think so.
Is it May 14, 2010?
It is.
Okay, what's wrong with this letter?
The letter says there are two things wrong with the letter. The first thing that's wrong with the letter is that it contradicts an email, a series of emails that are also in the record, in which Star and FEMA said internally, and also shared with Clackamas County, the elevation certificate is correct. Then there's an email from Clackamas County that says, oh, we don't want it to be, basically. I thought you were going to deny this. Or say
you just
there
was what, some corrupt official at FEMA issued this?
No, I didn't say it was a...
Well, what are you saying? I mean, I'm looking at the letter, and it does say that the entire... Well, I mean, you know it better than me, but it says it's below BFE.
The question is whether there's an issue of fact as to that, to begin with. If FEMA on one day says the elevation certificate is correct, and on another day says it's not, there's an issue of fact already. There are two different people from FEMA. Excuse me, could you tell me what the...
I'm asking you, is it ER 310? Is that where...
I'm going to look at 310. I'll get to it, and I will tell you what's wrong with it.
Or that's the wrong letter, maybe. That's the one I thought.
No. It's the right letter. No,
okay.
No, it's correct, the right letter. What it basically says is that based on the map.
No, it doesn't say based on the map. It says, our review of the technical data prepared by Dan Gilbert, surveyor, revealed that the described meets and bounds area requested for removal is located below the base flood elevation.
Well, Dan Gilbert specifically says that the base flood elevation is a certain amount.
They looked at this information and they concluded otherwise based on his information, not on the map.
How could they? I guess I'm confused here. Because earlier they said he was correct. And I did put that in the record. I forgot where it is. I'm sorry. But I did put that in the record. They said it was correct. Clackamas County said, oh, we don't want it to be correct. And then they came out with this letter. The important thing about this letter is that the case is considered incomplete. A formal denial letter will not be issued. In other words, there's nothing formal about this. And am I suggesting that this is corrupt? I'm suggesting that it's collusion, and I'm suggesting that this letter...
When you said earlier this was a private letter and not an official letter, that's certainly not true.
That's why I wanted to look at it, because you made it sound like it was some... I mean, it's on the official letterhead of FEMA.
There's no question about that.
Okay, but so what you're saying that this a reasonable jury could disbelieve that this was the official position of the agency?
FEMA didn't make, you know, they said it's not official. They said right there. This case is considered incomplete. A formal denial letter. If it were, yes, I think they could say this isn't formal. There's nothing formal about this, and they could compare the email certificate, the emails from Star and FEMA earlier, immediately earlier, within a week earlier, saying that it was correct. So what they're doing is the same thing Clackamas County did. They're looking at the map and they're saying our interpretation of the map is that you're wrong. But how do they get around the fact that 70305I says you have to use the elevation certificate for official? Yes, that's an issue. I agree that would be an issue of fact, but I don't. And I obviously disagree that FEMA made any such official determination with respect to this. That's the problem. I've got 1 minute and 21 seconds left, so I better stop.
You're actually over. But.
I'm over 121. Sorry.
Yeah, we'll give him that aside.
Good morning. You may please the court. My name is Daniel Rolfe, and I have the honor of representing the Mount Hood Corridor Community Planning Organization, or CPO, and its volunteer board members and land use chair at the time the events took place that are subject to the plaintiff's complaint. Even though counsel for the appellants did not address these issues, I'd like to briefly address questions regarding my client. The county attorney will argue the issues related to the county. I'd like to briefly make three points about the appeal with respect to the state law intentional interference with business relations tort claim that Big Mountain, the appellants, raised against my clients. The first point is that this court lacks jurisdiction over the appeal of that issue because the then plaintiffs in their amended complaint did not bring that state claim along into three subsequent amended complaints.
Well, why isn't the denial of one of these anti-SLAPP motions in Oregon more akin to a summary judgment ruling than a 12B6 dismissal that we would typically see? Because the cases you're relying on are obviously under our own civil rules, Rule 12B6. I look at the procedures set out in the Oregon anti-SLAPP statute, and it doesn't look anything like a 12B6 motion. It doesn't even look like a Rule 56 motion. It's actually a higher standard, I think our court has said, than what Rule 56 would say. So why weren't they entitled to treat the denial as basically a summary judgment type ruling, which our cases make clear? You don't have to keep repleting case claims that have been dismissed as summary judgment.
Your Honor, the jurisprudence of this court, specifically underlying in Lacey versus Maricopa County, does not turn on the issue of summary judgment or some factual consideration by the court. The standard articulated in Lacey is very clear. It says, quote, "For claims dismissed with prejudice and without leave to amend, we will not require that they be replayed in a subsequent amended complaint."
At the 12B6 stage, right? But isn't our case law equally clear that if you have summary judgment granted against you on a particular claim, and you then need, for whatever reason, to file an amended complaint, you don't have to keep repleting that claim that's already been dismissed at summary judgment, do you?
That's correct, Your Honor, because dismissal based on summary judgment is with prejudice, and therefore the party does not have leave to amend and cannot bring that claim back. However,
this is just because of the SLAPP motion, every time he, if he put it back in the way it was before, and then you had to redo your slap motion, then he's responsible for fees. Why should he have to do that?
Your Honor, that was also, the court considered that issue in an issue very similar to that in USS, in the USS Pasco case that we discuss in our brief. And there, what the attorney was actually sanctioned for repleting a claim, and the Ninth Circuit said, reversed those sanctions and said the attorney shouldn't be in a
position.
Yes,
but I thought that was because we were dealing with pre-Lacey law at that point.
That was pre-Lacey, that's correct, Your Honor, but still.
And it was that silliness, I think, that Lacey was trying to straighten out. I mean, it doesn't make sense for anybody for that to be the law. For the court to have to deal with a complaint about something. I mean, what are they supposed to do with that? Put a little asterisk saying we're only putting this in because the Ninth Circuit law requires us to do it, but please don't file another summary judgment motion. We agree we already lost. It just makes no sense.
Well, Your Honor, at that point, the plaintiffs would have two options. Number one, it could indeed, if the plaintiffs decided to file amended a complaint, it could indeed put that same claim in with a sentence in the complaint noting that
this was simply preserving it for
appeal.
What good would that do anybody?
What that would do is comply with the court's standard in Lacey, which is very clear.
In a practical sense, what good would that do anybody?
In a practical sense, what that would do is it would indicate to the defendants that claim was still, that the plaintiff still intended to pursue that claim. So in our case, Your Honor, what happened is there were three subsequent amended complaints. That claim disappeared from there as a claim.
If there's nothing more to be done about the claim. In other words, if they have nothing they want to amend about that claim, they're standing on the way it was litigated. If the rule was as I think it is, that they don't really have to reassert it, then you know that it's not out of the case. It's just a question of what's the rule. So there's no function in that.
Well, respectfully, Your Honor, I think slap suit defendants would not know that that's out of the case. So in our case, Your Honor, there were three subsequently amended complaints. That claim disappeared.
Well, what difference does it make whether it's in the case or out of the case? You're not going to litigate it anymore. It doesn't make a difference. An appeal, you'll worry about it.
Well, actually, respectfully, Your Honor, I think that is important to play, people in the position of my clients. One of the key issues that the Oregon legislature was trying to deal with is this chill that defendants feel when subject to this sort of onerous lawsuit. And so the whole anti-slap statute is trying to get defendants out of court as soon as possible. In the case of the state law tort claim...
It's going to look better if you take it out of the complaint than if you put it back in again.
Well, but that's an indication to the defendants that the plaintiffs will likely pursue this on appeal. As it was, we had no idea that this claim was going to come back into being until we literally read the appellant's opening brief.
So what?
Well, that just...
What would you have done differently if you'd seen it three more times?
That increases the uncertainty and increases the concern for... Well, Your Honor,
you lost evidence or anything else.
With all due
respect, seeing it three more times would just have meant three more anti-slap motions, right?
No, Your Honor, we would not have filed an anti-slap motion in the district court if it was indeed the same claims based on the same facts. There would be no reason for us to do that because the plaintiffs would have indicated that they were simply preserving that for appeal.
What else would you have done differently?
Well,
mentally preparing yourselves, you know, saying, oh my God, we now have to worry because we see it here. So we'll put
yes, Your Honor. Actually, that's really quite important to people in the position of my plaintiffs, or excuse me, of my clients.
They put them worried?
Yes. For example, this CPO has been inactive since this lawsuit was filed. Because No one will volunteer to be a part of an organization that is involved in an ongoing court case. And so finality is something that's very important.
The more worry we have familiarity with.
Well, that means that they didn't think it was gone. They thought it was still there.
If they would have known that it was still there, that would have at least alleviated the uncertainty, Your Honor. And I think uncertainty is important.
Likely people would join because they thought, oh, there's an additional claim still pending. That would have made it more likely to.
No, I don't think that would have made it more likely, but also.
Well, what do you mean?
It would have, again.
You often, there's a reason to say, look, this is vacant all this time because people are worried.
So that's right.
Well,
and
if
so.
If they had known there's an additional claim, they would have worried more, right? And that would have caused more people to worry.
For people in the position of my client, uncertainty can be worse than knowing exactly what to expect. And with that, I will. I see that my half of the argument is that time is up.
It goes nowhere fast.
So. It goes fast, Your Honor. And so.
It goes nowhere fast. So we'll give a chance to your co-counsel to say.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Good morning. If it pleases the court, my name is Alex Gordon. I'm here on behalf of Clackamas County and two of its employees, Mr. Steve Hanschke and Ms. Kim Benthie. We have, in this matter to a large degree, been overtaken by events. I'm sure you all will recall that there was a discussion in the brief about whether or not the decision by the Clackamas County Circuit Court Judge, Judge Tom, had an impact on the issues here, and specifically whether or not there was issue or claim preclusion. On the 23rd of September, the Oregon Court of Appeals addressed the issues presented in the appeal of Judge Tom's decision, which are indeed the same issues that are presented here as to whether or not the lot upon which the appellant wishes to construct a residence is in a floodway. If I may indulge, I will give you the citation. It's at 273 Oregon Appellate. I can.
But you didn't.
No, I just, it came at the end of September, Judge.
Fine. It's now already November.
It is true. I have no argument with that.
Well, the explanation. So you saw Springer here on all of us, opposing counsel?
I wouldn't say that, since the opposing counsel's been involved in representing Mr. O'Connor. It comes as no surprise to him. But I became aware of it more recently than the 23rd of September.
Okay, how recently? This morning before I met you while walking into court?
Last night.
Last night?
Yes. I thought that it might be of some interest to see how it had been pursued. I was examining the question.
Last night?
12:05 this morning.
Pacer works all night, you know.
Sir?
Pacer works all night.
It's true, it does. And so did my photocopier works this morning, and I have copies here as well.
Well, what's the, I'm sorry, this is the, what is this decision? I kind of missed
the decision it. Is that it was clear from the concessions made that, and the decision that the lot in question, 4400, is indeed in a floodway.
What is this, an appeal from, is it from that mandamus petition?
That's correct.
Okay. And so you're just saying that that decision got affirmed?
Yes.
Okay. But you, in your brief, only argued claim preclusion. You never,
I did.
You never argued issue preclusion.
That's true.
I did not see claim preclusion as attaching to this state court mandamus proceeding.
The Court of Appeals does speak of it in terms of claim preclusion, in terms of the claim as to the location of the tax lot.
Seems to me could only work if you're saying that they were obligated in that state court mandamus proceeding to bring this federal due process claim. I would assume they're not even able to litigate that in a state court mandamus proceeding. And obtain damages? Mandamus proceeding, in my mind, I'm not an Oregon practitioner, but it's, you know, you're trying to get an order to a government official to do something, right?
And there were two aspects of the mandamus. One was Mr. O'Connor was saying, I am entitled to have a permit issued because my lot, 4400, is not within the floodplain. And so that issue was specifically addressed.
Right.
In other words, are you telling us that what we should do is take the Oregon Court of Appeals conclusion as to that determination, i.e., whether it was in the floodplain or wasn't in the floodplain?
Yes.
As an answer to the main argument that was being made here today.
Yes.
That it's not in the floodplain. It wouldn't go to anything else. It wouldn't go to the due process issue insofar as it was based on the permitting system and whether or not that gave rise to a due process right or didn't. But it might go to the very limited argument that was made today.
Yes.
But that's not a claim preclusion argument.
It's not. It is a claim that was specifically raised. You're right.
It's an issue.
In that, yes.
Probably, right? I mean, they had a volunteer opportunity, presumably, to litigate that issue.
It's true.
They lost. It's now, in some sense, final, perhaps. I guess they can petition the Oregon Supreme Court
right.
for review. But at some point, finality will attach. And
at some point.
You would say that they shouldn't be allowed to relitigate that issue here. That all makes sense. I just was looking at your brief again to remind myself, and it looks like you only argued claim preclusion. It just didn't seem like the applicable document.
What, by the way, is Oregon? There are two strains of finality law. The federal courts are final at the end of the district court decision. But I believe the federal court would apply Oregon preclusion law to this. At what point is an Oregon decision final for issue preclusion purposes?
You are correct that the federal court would apply Oregon law, and the fact that a matter is on appeal does not affect the finality of the decision.
In Florida, it does in California. So you're sure about that, about Oregon?
I am. One of the appropriate focuses was what expectation did the appellant have that they would be allowed to build? The answer is none. The zoning and development regulations specifically say development in the floodway is prohibited. The lot is...
I guess that's why we had the argument made to us today in a way that was different from what I understood the briefs today, which was an argument that this isn't in the floodway. It isn't in the floodplain area. It is subject to the permitting system at all. Now, if that were right, I suppose that would be a mandatory and not discretionary decision. Is that right?
Not by Clackamas County, Your Honor. Clackamas County appropriately relies on the maps drawn by FEMA, and that is the reason why the appellant was referred to FEMA. Clackamas County does not modify the maps. They have appropriately designated that mapping to FEMA. Council's argument appears to be that FEMA should have done something differently.
What do you make of Council Site 703, Article 5I?
You may recall that there were two passages there with regard to whether or not there was official records or record keeping. That's not what we're concerned with here. We're concerned with whether or not the lot is within the floodway. That determination is based on maps that are made by FEMA. We have incorporated.
Is that how you answer my question?
It has nothing to do with it. What I make of it is they're parallel.
It seems to say that it seems to talk about the elevation certificate and reliance on it, and the opposing counsel says this is a positive. It's an ordinance, I guess, and it seems to say that it has to rely on the elevation certificate.
You will recall that the passage refers to rather limited circumstances.
I don't recall. I'm actually looking at the passage.
You will see that the passage refers to certain limited circumstances when that is necessary.
I don't see it. Why don't you show me where?
Can you tell me what section we're looking at here?
I can't because I didn't raise the question. I believe it's 703.05I, if I'm correct.
That's right. Do you have it in front of you?
I do not. I recall what you were saying because I was paying attention. But I don't have that in front of me now, Judge.
Well, how are you going to tell me what you're relying on?
My recollection of how it was read.
Tell me the language.
That for the purposes of official record keeping and reporting, that the base flood elevation certificate is to be relied upon.
I don't see it here. It says a form produced by the Federal Emergency Management Agency, FEMA, that is completed by a professional engineer, licensed architect, or licensed surveyor, usually so and so on. An elevation certificate is used to determine the relationship of grades, structures, and other facilities to the base flood elevation. It is also used to certify building elevations to ensure compliance with community floodplain regulations. None of the stuff you're talking about seems to be in there.
My recollection.
You want to see if opposing counsel will give you the. I just want to understand your position on this.
The last sentence, Your Honor, communities that participate in the community rating system are required to use an elevation certificate for all official reporting and record keeping of elevations. That's not what's at issue here. Clackamas County is not being challenged as to whether or not, in the course of participating in the community rating system, it's using elevation certificates for all official reporting and record keeping of elevations. The question is whether or not the FEMA map is to be amended. And in to that degree.
But that's the question as you phrased it. The opposing counsel says no. This seems to say that in making these decisions, you don't rely on the FEMA map, you rely on the elevation certificate. That's what they are arguing.
I'm at a loss as to how.
Where does it say? What's your answer to that argument?
That simply, that's not the language of that section.
Well, the section seems to me not to deal with determining the base flood elevation, but rather with demonstrating the grade structures and facilities, how they relate to that base flood elevation. In other words, I don't understand this certificate to go to whether the land as such is within the floodplain because it in the 100-year flood would be under the flood level. That doesn't seem to be what it's about. It's about how particular plans relate to that base flood elevation.
Well, Judge, I think it's even more narrow than that is set forth in the last sentence. And with all respect, my response is that's simply not what the sentence says. That's simply not what.
Well, it says all official reporting and record keeping of elevations shall be used for all official reporting and record keeping. How much broader can it be than that? That sounds very narrow to me.
That's all it means, Judge. We're not talking about that. We're talking about whether or not Clackamas County is to rely on the appellant's presentation of an elevation certificate to change the map drawn by FEMA. And that question does not involve official reporting and record keeping of elevations. Because that's not the activity we're talking about. We're not speaking about a system of official reporting by the county and record keeping of elevations. We're speaking of whether or not the lot is within the floodway as determined by maps produced by FEMA.
Isn't it so circular? Isn't that sort of circular?
I don't believe so, Judge, but obviously we disagree on that. I view the plain, what I see is the plain language of that section quite differently from you. I do not see that the activities that we are speaking of today are official reporting and record keeping of elevations by Clackamas County.
Well, how can you have official reporting and record keeping actions, if you like, the official records and reporting, report one thing, how can you take action, how can the county take other actions like this?
You would, of course, be correct, but whether or not FEMA has determined that the lot is within the floodway is not an official reporting or record keeping of elevations, qua elevations, by Clackamas County. And I think we just simply disagree on where that plain language takes us, but I'm not aware of any argument that's been presented that determining by FEMA whether or not a lot is within the floodway involves official reporting and record keeping of elevations by a community participating in the community rating system. I haven't heard any argument that that's what is at issue here. But I assume my time is over.
At ER 266 to 268, the conversations with FEMA, and the first one is on May 5th at 10:30 in the morning, from FEMA to Steve Hanska, and it says, our engineer checked the survey data against the Sandy River data that was sent to us, and it is correct. And she says, I'm going to email the Loma Clearinghouse study and tell him to prepare the Loma if that is okay with you. That's at 10:30 in the morning. That's at 10:30 in the morning on the 5th. At 8 o'clock at night, Mr. Hansker writes her back and says, how can you do that? Because we didn't file the community acknowledgement form. We were expecting you to deny this. And then the next thing is from a guy named Radcliffe, who says, I know what we can do. We can say that you can't sign the community acknowledgement form because there's fill in the, because the revetment is fill. What?
You were reading and quoting before, and now you're not quoting.
What? Oh, okay. He says, the county never signed the community acknowledgement form, which is what compelled us to check with you folks to begin with. So how can you approve the Loma? That's what Mr. Hanska says.
Thanks,
and then Mr. Radcliffe says, I just spoke with Denise at FEMA, and I think we came up with a plan. And then he describes what the plan is, which is you don't have to sign the community community acknowledgement form because there's the revetment is fill. We'll say the revetment is fill. You don't sign a community acknowledgement form, and the effect of that is because STAR will not issue a formal opinion because there's no community acknowledgement form.
FEMA, though, confirm or back up the county's determination that that revetment will constitute a fill?
Did what?
Did FEMA end up agreeing with the county that the revetment wall did, in fact, constitute fill?
Yes, but no one, but that wasn't the issue, is whether or not the footprint was fill. Because that's what the Loma was for. The Loma was not for the revetment. It was for the footprint. It was for a specific meets and bounds within the property. And then the Loma said, we want to build on this property because it's above BFE. And Hansha admitted, and other people admitted, I don't have the exact citation, that there was no fill on the footprint. That's what they were saying. So he can't get a Loma because they won't allow him. They won't sign the community acknowledgement because they said there's the revetment is filled.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Case you saw, you will stand submitted. We are adjourned.